We are going to solve a crypto challenge with some cool math. I think it's an awesome example of linear algebra applied to some real-world security problems. The story about this challenge is that we have a firmware update that will only be applied if verified and works by hashing files and folders with SHA-256 and XORing those hashes together. The resulting XORed result is then checked against a signature. If you want to hear more about how we explore different attack ideas, you can check out part 1. But in this part, I just want to focus on the mathematical solution and try to provide an intuitive understanding for the linear algebra involved. And I'm also sorry to all the mathematicians out there if I butcher some terminology. I'm a math noob. Okay. So to understand the solution, I have to introduce two concepts. One is about linear independence and how linear independent vectors in some vector space can match to any point. And the second concept will be Galois fields or finite fields, specifically the GF2, the field of only two elements. If you didn't learn this kind of math, for example at university or you are still too young, then these terms sound crazy, but I want to mention them because while it sounds crazy, I think it's really easy to understand once I explained it. So let's start with linear independence of vectors. If you are not familiar with vectors, just ignore the term and just see how we are using it. They are basically just arrows. So imagine a one-dimensional space, so just a line of numbers, and I give you a one-dimensional vector. Now, a vector is like an arrow, so this vector starts at 0, it points to 2. With a scalar, or just a regular number, we can multiply that vector to move that arrow around. For example, 2 times the vector will point to 4, and 4 times the vector will point to 8, and minus 3 times this vector will point to minus 6. Easy. And as you know, multiplication is just fancy addition. 4 times the vector, we just add the vector to itself 4 times. So you see that with this one vector, we multiply it with some value, we can make it point to every number in that one-dimensional space. Now let's look at this in two-dimensional space, just a flat surface. We add another axis. Now let's take one vector, for example 1, 1. Now a vector will have two values, x and y. Now this is an arrow that points to this point 1, 1. Again, we can multiply a scalar or just add subtract this vector many times and we can move around where it points to. With 2 times this vector we point to 2, 2. With 5 times we point to 5, 5. And with minus 3 times this vector we point to minus 3, minus 3. But you see that we can't add or subtract and reach every value on our plane. We only ever can reach any point on this line. So let's introduce a second vector, 3, 3. Now this one points to 3, 3. And again, we can add or subtract it. We can even combine our two vectors, but we are still limited to this line. You might also have noticed that we could basically create this vector by taking our first vector 3 times. These two vectors are linearly dependent. But if we get a vector that is linearly independent, that is not laying on the same line, for example 1, 0, now we can't reach this point with only the first vector, and vice versa. The new vector can't reach a point of the second vector, except of course 0, but we can now use them together to get any point on this two-dimensional field. For example, to reach the point 3, 5, we can take the first vector 5 times, now we are at 5, 5, and then we take the second vector and subtract it 2 times and now we reach 3, 5. And so with two independent vectors, we can get to any point of the two-dimensional field. And this also works with three dimensions. If you have three linear independent vectors in this three-dimensional space, you can get to any point you want by adding or subtracting them. That makes sense, right? Just think about it for a second and imagine in your head how you can combine three different arrows in a three-dimensional space and reach any point in there. And of course, it also works in four, five, or higher dimensional space. In 4 dimensions, we need 4 linear independent vectors, and in 5 dimensional space, we need 5 linear independent vectors, and so on. Of course, you can't really visualize that anymore, but you can just write them down as vectors and play around with adding and subtracting them from another to reach any point you want. Amazing, right? But if you have very large vectors, it's a bit cumbersome by hand to select the vectors you want to add or subtract to reach certain points. That's where you get into linear algebra. You just put all these vectors as columns into a matrix. Here's the point you want to reach, and then you can solve this. But we don't have to do this by hand. We can let the computers do that for us. Okay, so what the heck does this have to do with this challenge? We get there. Patience. So, now let's introduce the second concept.
Finite field is already a fancy sounding name, but there's a much nicer name for it, Galois field. That's a nice French name, right? Okay. So when you want to tell your girlfriend or your boyfriend or your mother, whoever you want to impress, what you did today at the university, you say, I learned about Galois fields, okay?
Specifically, we want to have a look at GF, Galois field 2. Ah, it sounds so cool, but it's really dumb, but clever. Basically, throw away any numbers you know and just keep 2, 0 and 1. And you live now in a world where only 0 and 1 exists. The binary world. No 2, no 3, only 0 and 1. Now let's think about how addition could look like in this world. 0 plus 0 could be 0, that makes sense. 0 plus 1 could be 1, that makes sense too. So does 1 plus 0, that's also 1. But 1 plus 1 is a bit weird because in our world there is nothing larger than 1. And so we are imprisoned in this world, and if we try to leave here to find the larger number, we just wrap around in our world and arrive at the start again, like the game Snake. And as a computer scientist, do you notice something? What is this? This is XOR. Addition in the finite field of two elements, GF2, is equivalent to the logical XOR operation. Ding, 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 ding. Does it ring a bell? So when we XOR, for example, 2 bytes, each byte has 8 bits, 8 ones or zeros, for example, hex 55 in ASCII, the capital letter U, it would be 0101, 0101. And if we XOR that with D9 in binary, 1101, 1001, we get 1000, 1100, or hex 8C. So these bytes could also be understood as a vector. It's an 8-dimensional vector with 8 elements, either 0 or 1. They are vectors in an 8-dimensional GF2 vector space. Each vector has 8 bits, and a bit exists only in a world of 0 or 1. A bit can never be 2, it's always 0 or 1. And we just learned that XOR in GF2 is like addition. So now we just added 2 vectors together and got another point in that vector space. And this means a SHA-256 hash has 256 bits and can be understood as a 256-dimensional vector in a Galois field 2 vector space. And the first concept we learned about was that if we have enough linear independent vectors, we can add or subtract them to reach any point in that space. So if we had 256 linear independent vectors, 256 linear independent SHA-256 hashes, we could reach any point in the 256-dimensional space. And the point we want to reach is the 256-bit vector, or better to say, the final XOR result of the hashes that is already valid and signed. So if we can create these 256 linear independent vectors, we should be able to combine them by addition, or as you know now, XOR, to craft any XOR result that we want. In mathematical terms, we just have to solve this matrix equation of the 256 independent vectors with the vector that we want. Any XOR result that we want. And actually that is very simple. Hashes are basically random data, random bits. They are a random vector. And it's very unlikely that such a random vector is linear dependent. But you can also very easily test that. So let's start by creating 256 linear independent bit vectors. or vectors operating in GF2. To do this, I'm using Sage, which is basically a tool to perform mathematical calculations. Sage scripts are basically Python. The code gets transformed into Python script and then is executed. Also, as explained in part 1, I did not come up with this. The solution and the code I show was written by Benoffs from our CTF team. Just so that you don't get the wrong impression that I'm some kind of wizard. He is. So we can start with a loop to find these independent vectors. We know how the hashes are generated by the firmware installer. Check out part 1 if you forgot. So we do the same here now. We generate a file name from just counting numbers and append the null byte. And then pass it to something that will return the 256-bit vector for it. The make vector function takes the file name, generates the SHA-256 hash, and then goes over each byte of that hash. For each byte, it extracts the single bits. It does that via lookup table of bits that was generated at the start of the program. Long story short, that function will just return the vector with all 256 bits of the hash. Now that we have the vector that represents the hash for this file, we can create a matrix of all the possible vectors defined over the Galois field 2, GF2, and then we can check the rank of the matrix. In linear algebra, the rank of a matrix is the dimension of the vector space generated by its columns. This corresponds to the maximum number of linearly independent columns of the matrix. So, if the new vector increases the rank of the matrix, so increases the number of linear independent columns of the matrix, then we can keep that one. And we just remember all the vectors and file names that are good. And we can also print if a vector wouldn't be linear independent. If we run that now, it takes a moment for Sage to get going, and then we print out all the file names that produces linear independent vectors. And you can see, after the first 256, we didn't even get one that was linear dependent. Next, we have to define the point in our 256-dimensional vector space that we want to reach by combining our vectors. To do that, we have to read the current valid XOR result, the one that is signed. And then we do our modifications of the pre-copy Python script to spawn a shell, and then we get the new invalid XOR result. If we XOR those two, we get our target goal. If we can somehow craft this XOR result with our files, basically find which vectors we have to combine to reach that point in space, then they could be XORed with the now invalid XOR result to produce the valid signed result. And we take the result now and define a goal vector, and then we can take the matrix of all our vectors and say that we want to solve the systems of equations for the goal vector to the right. Basically, just solve the matrix equation, and the resulting vector will tell us which vector we take and not take. Where we have a 1, we take it, where we have a 0, we don't take it. Or to be more mathematical, we multiply the first vector with 1 and add it, we multiply the second vector with 1 and add it, and we take the third vector and multiply it with 0 and add it, and so forth. So we can now loop over this resulting vector, and wherever we have a 1, we print the name of the file we have to create in order to craft the corresponding XOR result. And if we do all of that, we can create the new zip update file with all those chosen files, and that would have a modified pre-copy script, but a valid signature. And so we can connect again to the service and send our modified update zip. It gets unpacked, the signature checked, and the pre-copy script is executed. And this should have now spawned a shell on the server that we can use to look around and in the end read out the flag. Boom! Solved! Isn't that amazing?